So meaning they went through challenges and they came out stronger than they went into it. That's what a resilient family is. We can go through the storms of life. We can go through the wind and every kind of affliction and situation, but we will right come out what? Stronger than ever. Because we are better together. We are better together. Hallelujah. I promise you, every tree you find without a root is a tree that is a mirage. It won't last. It will soon disappear. You will soon look for it and you will not find it. Everyone needs a root. Everybody needs a hope. Everybody needs a family. You can't survive all by yourself. It is actually very dangerous to be isolated. Very dangerous. It is not secure, it is not safe when you have nobody around you. It is not safe at all. So you need each other. You need each other. We need each other. I want you to look around and find one or two persons around you and say, I need you. I need you in my life. You're very important to me. Yes, we have our differences. We have our differences. Yes. But the fact that you are different from me, the way you think, makes you unique. Our God is a God of variety. You are good the way you are. You complement my life. So what is missing in me, you make up for it. Imagine if both your right hand and your left hand are equally strong, and then none is stronger than the other. In fact, I discovered that even there is no part of the body that is exactly the same. So many things that I found out will be shocked. That the left leg is not exactly the same size. Yes. Have you found out? Too?
Yes.
And then we went for some tests and just realized that they put you before the glass and before those machines. And you begin to look, they are checking the left eye as against the right one. You just realize that the other one is perfect and the other one has a little defect. And so they begin to want to chart a way to bring correction. Praise the Lord. So the fact that somebody could be weaker than you does not make them inferior or unneeded. We need each other. You understand? You see, when you form an army, that I put my hand in this very leg, and you put your hand in my leg like this, it is impossible for the enemy to push us down. We form a wall that cannot be broken or defeated. Now, we must not break the link. You are linked to me, I am linked to someone else. When we come together like that, we become a formidable army.
Amen.
And we can take on any situation, any challenge. And that's why a family unit is exactly the strongest instrument or institution that God has as the final solution to defeat the enemy. Amen. The family. That's exactly the beginning of the church. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So I want to say with that happy family month and happy family day to every powerhouse member.
Amen.
And I begin with my sweet, amazing, God-given, Holy Ghost, consecrated girlfriend. Hallelujah. You are not allowed to have a girlfriend as a powerhouse. consecrated here, consecrated and consecrated by Jehovah.
Amen.
So I salute God's beauty and God's honor and the treasure that she is to me and to the church.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
She makes me, you know, some people say I'm putting on flesh.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, say it again.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So I thank God for her. No, you can't blame me. If you don't have anybody to celebrate in your life, you have to be fixed today. In the message of today, you have to be fixed.
Amen.
You need to be fixed. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And I know God will fix you.
Amen.
He will fix you.
Amen.
Today, I want to speak very quickly because of our time, building a strong and resilient family. Building a strong and resilient family. Like I said before, the family unit is God's own program for us to take dominion on the earth, to replenish the earth, to subdue it, and to reign and govern on his behalf. And God's strategy has never failed. It has been from generation to generation, from Genesis to Revelation. God's strategies are winning strategies.
Yes.
It never failed.
Amen.
I know the day and the times we are in, we are in a generation where marriages do not work again.
Mm-hmm.
Families are in shambles. People don't have any respect or regard to family institutions anymore. Families seems not to be working. You hear broken homes, broken families here and there. The father is against the mother is against the children are against and rebellious to their parents. That's what we have these days. And the scripture already foretold that there will be a day and there will be a generation that will be like this. Hallelujah. Let's start reading the scriptures. We'll read a lot of scripture and I'll take it slow because I have certain things to share with you this morning. When you look at Proverbs chapter 30, Proverbs 30, we're looking at verse 12. Come on now. Proverbs 30, verse, is it 12 or 22? Okay. Proverbs 30, I read verse 11. Verse 11. TPT puts it in a way I like, but my distant doesn't seem to want to answer. But if you look at King James' version, but I like TPT, everybody can find it. There is a generation that curses fathers and refuse to bless mothers. Not in my generation. I refuse to be part of that generation. Say it very seriously. Please say it, because it's a prophetic statement that you will not participate in the abuse of parents. I mean, we have no existence without parents. And God intentionally planted us by whatever parents we have at the moment. There are no coincidences in our lives. God, none of us was part of the arrangement of who my parents should be. I didn't choose who my parents should be. You are not supposed, whether spiritual or biological, you cannot choose. It is beyond you. God, the omniscient, the one who knows all things, planted you by himself to have come out of that mother of yours that you do not respect or regard. That father of yours that you do not have respect for should be the one to better you. So everything is in sync with God's original plan. You are where you are today in the family because God orchestrated it. Are you hearing me?
Amen.
And without your family, possibly you will not even be alive now. Praise the Lord. So there is a generation that you will never be part of. They are the generation rising up who will curse their fathers. That TPT says there is a generation rising up. Thank you.
Speaks evil of their mother.
That's not my generation. Please make a choice, because we know the end of this whole story. We know where they are headed. Because the word says for us, honor thy father and thy mother, so that your days will be long. And it might be what? Well with you. So if a generation begins to rise that cares less about who a father is and has no regard for motherhood, then you know where they are headed. I'm sure we know that the end is better than the beginning. It is my prayer that you will end well. Remember, we are not here to stay forever. I pray for you, you will end your journey well.
Amen.
The word says better is the end of a thing than the beginning thereof. If you become roughly due to circumstances of life, make sure you flip the situation so that you can end well. So that the things I was unable to enjoy, even in my childhood, I should be able to overcome them and make sure they are available for the children that will come through me. So that they can have a good beginning and so they can also finish well. You might have started roughly, but my desire is that you finish well.
Amen.
May you finish your journey well in the name of Jesus. When I look right behind my shoulders, I just look back, you know, I look at myself as a young man. I see myself 10 years, 15 years, 18 years down the line, and it just looks like yesterday. But now, I'm calling and counting decades of existence. So you just see that times run fast. Everything is running so fast. A time there was my little girl running around. But in a very short time, you are beginning to see clear. You don't get old. Before you know it, you are able to count 20, 30 years, 40. And that's what happens to all men. There is no medicine to stop the process. So the one who looks like a child today, in a very short time, you become a mother. I remember, whatever you sow, so what you are pretending not to understand now is just a matter of time. Hallelujah. And it will be your turn. It will soon be your turn. Hallelujah. It is my prayer that you will end well.
Amen.
Say, I will end well in the name of Jesus. Let me see how far I can go with this. But it is important that we establish this foundation. A resilient family is that family with the ability to withstand and to rebound. You withstand and rebound from the life's challenges that is coming against our generation. You will not only withstand, meaning you stand face to face, you have the capacity to resist and hold your ground against all confrontation and against every abuse, against all the challenges coming against you in your marriage, your family life. You are resilient only when you are able to withstand them, and then you rebound from those challenges.
Oh, yes.
And you become stronger.
Amen.
And that's what your family will be like.
Amen.
Families are heavily challenged. Families are heavily attacked. And people are so disunited, disjointed. Families are so shattered and beaten, battered by the enemy. And the statistics had it that about 70% of Christian families are broken. Right now, as you speak, only about 30 barely are making it through what we can call successful families. My prayer is Powerhouse Ministries, all of us together, will be one of the 30% that is succeeding.
Amen.
Your family will not break up.
Amen.
Your family will not break apart.
Amen.
There is a public or general saying that you don't know what you have until you lose it. You will not have to lose your family before you understand the value they bring it when they bring it to your life. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are not going back to where you are coming from. That's the long and short of the story. You will not go back to where you are coming from. Where are we coming from? You are coming from unprotected. You're coming from a state where you are empty and naked, a pity of everybody. But now you are covered. You will not go out of that covering. I thought you heard what I said. You won't come out of it in the name of Jesus Christ. The Lord who brought you that cover will secure you in that cover. And everything your life needs shall be provided in the name of Jesus Christ. It is an abuse to be solo. When you are solo, just all by yourself, you know, one of the greatest ways to punish a criminal is to put them in isolated cells. When you isolate people, you kill them before they reach death. You kill them mentally, you kill them emotionally, you kill them every way possible. It's the highest form of punishment that you can give to humans. Because according to our DNA, we are relational beings. We can't survive without each other. We can't. You think you can make it all by yourself? You lied. You can't. You need me and I need you.
Amen.
I hope I'm speaking to somebody this morning. So that would be a point of check to tell us that let us stop destroying each other. Your families are not perfect. But with love in our heart, we can work it out.
Amen.
And you must not seek to change each other all of the time. You need the uniqueness in each other.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You do. The leg cannot do the work of the eyes. The eyes cannot do the work of the fingers. So the fingers are planted where they were planted because God knows that's the best place and position for it. The neck was planted as the neck and not the head, because God knows the use of the neck. Therefore, the neck is unique. The head is important. The legs are very, very important. Even the trunk, the torso, very important too. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So tap somebody close again and say, you are important to me.
You are important to me.
From today, I refuse to despise you. And the last thing, say, I honor you, being my family member.
I honor you, being my family member.
I can't replace with anyone else.
I
hallelujah.
Amen.
So, meaning they went through challenges and they came out stronger than they went into it. That's what a resilient family is.
Yeah.
We can go through the storms of life. We can go through the wind and every kind of affliction and situation, but we will right come out what? Stronger than ever.
Amen.
Because we are better together.
Amen.
We are better together.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
There is not one family on earth that you can point to and you look all around and they are perfect. Not one. Not one. Why are you expecting perfection from your own family? You bring in too much expectation on that family. You are stressing the family. No, there is no competition within the family place. We are complementing each other. So that one that looks like a star and seems to be burning brighter actually should be a compliment to you, and you are a compliment to it. Yes. Celebrate it, because when it comes to your time, hallelujah,
amen,
they can't replace you with anyone else.
Amen.
Your position is unique.
Amen.
If you are a child within a family, your position is unique.
Amen.
It's irreplaceable.
Amen.
If you are a mother in a family, your position is what? Unique. Irreplaceable. If you are a father in a home, no one can replace you. Your assignment is unique. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So let's begin to celebrate each other and be always in alignment. Praise the Lord. I understand Jesus said, a man's enemy are the people of his household. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But I want us to understand that our family, there is no devil within.
Amen.
The devil we have to confront is the devil without.
Amen.
What do I mean by that? There is no human being that is your exact enemy. They are used by spirits. They are used, they are manipulated. They are upset by wicked spirits, foul spirits. And they are used, they are turned against you to do the master's bidding. Satan is behind the scene, manipulating the process. How about dealing with the enemy that is invisible, and then win your brother to yourself? Praise the Lord. So your families will be strong as for today.
Amen.
Why do we need strength in the family? Strength is needed. And that's why Ephesians chapter 6 verse 1 and verse 10 will tell you, finally brothers, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. When you go to verse 17 and 18, he says, finally taking the shield of faith, wherewith we'll be able to quench the fiery darts of the devil. So the reason why we need to be strong is that we need to quench some enemy's dirt. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 3 says, well, we know we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities. It talks about the weapon of our warfare, they are not carnal, but they are mighty through God. To the pulling down of what? Strong. We have some things to pull down. We have some enemies to pull down. The structures of darkness we got to pull them down. In Jeremiah chapter 50 verse 20, the word 51 verse 20, the word says, you are my battle axe.
Yeah.
You are my weapon of war.
Yeah.
He said, with you, I will pull down nations.
Yes.
I will destroy kingdoms.
Yes.
And when we look at the book of Matthew, the Bible says, every tree that is not planted by the Heavenly Father will what? Will be uprooted. So we have enough assignments. Enough assignment that God has given to us. And the assignment is so real, the enemy is so vicious, that we cannot afford to exempt him and begin to fight each other. Praise the Lord. In Psalms 127 verses 1 down to 3, the word says, except the Lord build the house, those who are building and laboring in vain. I know this is beyond your capacity. Building is beyond our human capacity. Some of us have done your best, and the thing is just not lining up. We do not ignore your pain. We are equally not underrating the sacrifices you are putting to make sure things work. Currently, it doesn't seem like working, but God, we help you build.
Amen.
He is the master builder.
Amen.
There are those who are here, you've been looking for families you can call your own. You've been looking for people you can truly feel safe with. And your heart cries out for a mother, a father, who will just be there for you the way you wanted it. And it looks like every effort you make, you are losing it. You've met them with the wrong people. And you are in pain everywhere. But may I say to you that God, the master builder, will step into your case today.
Amen.
So it is in vain for us to set up early and to sit up late, eating the bread of sorrow. But God gives the people he loves sleep. Let me prophesy on somebody. That may the Lord step peace into that marriage, into that family life. How come our peace in the name of Jesus Christ? That chaos, that violence, that torture in your spirit, that pain that you carry, I speak peace in the name of Jesus Christ. You are a beloved of the Lord, and you are not supposed to be ravaged, your heart ravaged all of the time in pain and in worry. I speak peace like Jesus did. Into your life, into your marriage, into your family, in the name of Jesus Christ. Ask peace. Between yourself and your wife, between the fathers and the children. Peace between the mothers and the children. Ask peace round about in the name of Jesus Christ. To the child, receive peace.
Amen.
To the man and the woman, receive peace in the name of Jesus. And Satan, I rebuke you by the power and the authority of God's word.
Amen.
Take your hands off God's families.
Amen.
Release God's family from your grip in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I condemn your work by the power and the blood of Jesus. I release peace upon the families in the name of Jesus. We remember that our family is constituted of the father, the mother, and the children. We call them children. And it doesn't matter how old you are, as long as you are not married out already to go and start another home. Is still considered as children of the family.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So you must fall somewhere, either a father or a mother, or you are in the children category. And I want to talk to these three dimensions. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, looking at the children, you have a command from God. And the command is very simple. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1 down to 3. The command is very simple. Can we look at it? Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1 down to 3. It said, children, obey your parents and the Lord. That's all you've got to do. Actually, two instructions. Obey your parents and the Lord, for this is good. To obey. To obey is to submit to the authority of your parents. Simple dictionary meaning. Submit to the authority of your parents. Conform to their instructions. Heed their instructions. Listen attentively to their instructions. Hallelujah. So to obey is to conform to their instructions, to heed the instructions of your parent, and to listen attentively to what they are saying to you. Now the second instruction God gave to the children is honor your parents. Honor. So obey and honor. To honor our parents simply means, as the first one I read out, to honor our parents simply means submit to their authority and comply with their rules. It means place value upon them. reference them. Some of us will do it physically, as if we respect, but our heart is not. And you know, unfortunately, you are not dealing with them. You're dealing with God in this case. You say, hello, mommy. But you are rebellious in your heart. Your heart is not saying so. So you're not dealing with the mommy. You're dealing with the God of the mommy who placed mommy there. So honor begets honor. If you do not honor them genuinely from your spirit, it cannot be well with you. Unfortunately, that's what the scripture says. And since we are not doing motivation, we want to allow God to build us a home of great men and women. We do not want to be pushed down by the challenges of the community, the situation in the nations. We want to be people who withstand and withstand the challenges of life. You need to honor genuinely your parents in your heart, as if God is standing before you all of the time. Obey them. Comply with their rules. You don't have to like it, but it's a rule, and it's a rule from the one set ahead of you. Comply. Comply. Don't do it maliciously. Comply, says the Lord. We are reading together, isn't it? That's why I'm taking it so easy, so that everybody will understand. I don't have to preach anything here. You just have to hear it from God himself.
Amen.
So to honor them is to place value on them. Respect them. Reference them. You don't have another one. And in this case, you have no choice because you didn't choose them. Hallelujah. Jesus came to a point and said, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. And you should go forth and bear fruit and let your fruit remain. John chapter 15. God chose them for the work that they are doing. So why not honor them and obey them so that it can be well with you and you can live long? Praise the Lord. Now, stepping away from that, when you get on, you read Ephesians chapter 6, verses 1 to 3. It will guide you through this. Coming close to that is the wives. And when you say wives, meaning we see mothers. So, you may not be anybody's wife right now, but you are a mother to somebody. This is for you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Who are the mothers? The Bible calls wives help meet. And there is this misconception. I also was there to believe that the wife is exactly playing the role of the Holy Ghost in the life of the husband. But I realized that we are given too much to the woman. You cannot play the role of the Holy Ghost in a man's life. So no wife is the husband's Holy Ghost. It's blasphemy. Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost is God himself. When your wife becomes your God, you have lost it. That's what happened in the Garden of Eden. So it's not every suggestion from mama or madam that you just go ahead and do. No. You have to hear God. When they suggest things to you, it should not be the first time you are hearing it if it is from God. It should be confirmatory.
Yes.
The real person God deals with in the family issue is the man. You are the one who's to carve out what the vision of the house is. So if your madam is the one in charge of the house, it's a house that will not last long. No matter how foolish and how stupid your husband may seem, allow him to lead. It's the Lord. Truth. So but let's look at the wives. In 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 32. Please help me flash. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 32. And I have to be fast on this. The first role of the woman. And the spirit of the prophet is subject to the prophet. Even the Holy Ghost does not force anybody to do anything. And does not manipulate anybody to do anything. So first of all, the woman is not the Holy Ghost. Secondly, even if you were the Holy Ghost, you are not supposed to force or manipulate the man to do what he was not convinced of doing. Praise the Lord. So your position is to be the help. Now, the point we miss is help comparable or compatible to him. You are a helper in the places where the man is weak. God is not an author of confusion. If the man is already strong in an area, you cannot be a helper there. So you see the woman excelling at her responsibilities in the points where the man is weak. So if the man is a man full of anger, who has issue, temperament issue, you see the woman is supposed to be the quiet one who blends the family. The man cannot be fire and the woman fire at the same time. Do you understand what I'm saying? You burn the house down. So where the man is weak, the woman is supposed to have strength because she complements the man. So if your wife now is good in a particular area and she begins to do her work, you should be proud as a man and celebrate the fact that your wife was able to discover her gift and her calling in your life. Celebrate her. Be happy, be joyful. Don't feel threatened that thing you are wicked, she is able to supply. It is a balance that God is trying to create. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So the woman did not come to your life to compete with you. She did not come to your life. You must know this. She did not come to your life to take over from you. She's playing her role. So if she does it well, celebrate her. And even if you feel there are some weaknesses, encourage. Push her further so she can get you into a higher ground. Praise God. So the helper, John chapter 14 verse 26, looking at certain qualities or attributes or certain jobs that the woman is expected to do in our lives, the mothers, but the comforter. First of all, the mothers are comforters. They are comforters. I can't tell you enough, I actually lack the right words to express how comforted I am now. But you can see yourselves.
Amen.
Isn't it?
Yes.
See, somebody called me sometimes and just said, look, I am so happy to see you in this new you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Very rare of her to ever confront me and tell me the things like this. So, the woman is who? A comforter. Some of you have got good beds and you go look for the expensive thing called comforter. The job of warmth, the job of cementing everything together, the job of making the home cozy and alive, that's the mother. Hallelujah. In case you don't have a mother in your life, may the Lord from today begin to fix that aspect of your life in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You are missing the position of somebody bringing you comfort. Receive health from God in the name of Jesus Christ. So she's first of all a comforter. And which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name. They are sent once. Mothers are sent. I promise you, if another person, if someone else had given birth to you, you won't be what you are now. Maybe you will be a stillbirth. But I told you to be through the Lord's people. So you are good enough as a mother. Let me encourage mothers here. You are a good mother.
Yes.
Your children might not be telling you that, but I want you to know, I say it on behalf of God, you are a good mother. A good mother. I mean, it's actually time for some of us children to be able to walk to our parents. You don't know what they went through, haven't you? That you are who you are today. You need to be able to walk to them and look them right in the face. If there's anything like another life, you are still my choice. You are the best mother ever. Some of us, we criticize them. We see that they have not done enough. We are upset with them. And you don't even have a bit of understanding of the things they have gone through to be where they are at the moment. We need to appreciate them.
Amen.
We need to thank them intentionally. Go to them. Some, you want to greet them. Hello, mommy. You're already walking away. That's rudeness. He says you are not even intending to say it in the first place. Our children in the church, you know, we were teaching them. You don't greet an elder in person. It means you are not raised well. You don't greet an elder in person. Look at me in the face, not staring at me. You understand what I'm saying? As in, who do you think you are? No. Look at me in the face. As the book of Psalms says, like young lad looking unto their father for provision. Gentle as a lamb, look unto me, greet me with respect, and wait for me to respond. That's honor, not a human. And we look at you and say, it's better you don't even do it. This must never be lost in your life. I saw some things in American movie, and then I think it's a clip from American distance. The mother was doing this TikTok with the daughter, and they are getting a lot of views. And then he called the mother by name. Again, let's do this. The mother looked at it. Right on the same TikTok. I won't wait until later. Right live like that. I want you to know that I raised you better than this. You call me by name now. Or refer to me as you guys. You are not raised like that. You are not raised like that. So mothers should be honored, respected. And I just said that to say mothers will honor you, will recognize you. We know your works in our lives and we thank you. Then going further, he says, teaching. Mothers are supposed to teach. Now this is the point of challenge to mothers. Please, your assignment is clear. You cannot, because you love the children, and then over pamper them. You need to teach them the values that you already acquire. Pass it on. Pass it on. If you look at Proverbs chapter 31, the virtuous woman, you are the type that will teach. You have to pass your true virtues to your children. Pass it on. Pass it on. Whatever you have in you that makes you this good, it will be in vain if you cannot transfer it to the ones coming behind you. Are you hearing me? Mothers, you cannot be busy doing things for the kids. Don't come and clean their room for them. Teach them how to do that. Teach them how to do that. to brush their teeth very well,
Amen.
To speak before people,
yes.
Teach them morality, teach them decency,
Amen.
Teach them self-esteem. You can be good and there is nobody eating it from you, then I will question that goodness in you. It's a fluke.
Amen.
You are a leader because you are able to raise other leaders.
Amen.
Are you hearing anybody?
Yes.
Your responsibility is to teach.
Amen.
Don't be tired. Teach us. We children will want to learn. Am I speaking your mind, children?
Amen.
Teach us. Don't overpower us. Show us what we must know. Don't excuse us. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And then come in front. Remind them about who they are. Talk to them. Talk to them. Help them. That love in your heart. Use it to teach, to train, to assist them. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Don't assume they are okay. They are teachers, so let's start from the top. They are virtuous and they must be submissive to their husbands. Number two, they are comforters. Number three, they are teachers. Number four, they remind us of things that are valuable and important. So many of the lessons I have in my life today, and you see me giving you adages upon adages, it is for my mother. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Give them serious truth that they can never leave. And finally, I think verse 26 or verse 27. Verse 27. Jesus says, peace I give to you. Isn't it as the word of peace? He said, peace I live with you. A true mother, a real mother, brings peace to the house. Are you a woman of peace? You are the one that creates the balance so that the fire does not burn the house. Create peace in your own homes.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I know the time, but God will give them wait. We will finish now. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Lastly, the man. Praise the Lord.
The man.
The man is the one who must carve out the vision of the house. If you don't have a vision from which you are living, then getting married to a woman is confusion. Because the woman was created to help you in your vision. So you should know where you are going clearly. You must be clear about the direction of the home. You are called to lead. So first of all, you are a man of vision. Secondly, you must have direction. I was telling in our family meeting, I think on Saturday, I was saying, if I made it to go to Pretoria, what is the direction of Pretoria, everybody? Where is Pretoria? Direction, which side? Is it this side?
Yeah.
Mommy said this side. Now, if I wanted to go to Pretoria, but I began to go this direction, I'm moving, isn't it? But in the wrong direction. So I'm not going to get there. And if by chance the road finds a way to link up to Pretoria, I would have wasted a lot of my time. I'm making movements, but in the wrong direction. A man must have direction. If you are still struggling with direction, you will have a problem with a woman. Because the woman wants a man that is precise. He knows where we are going. And he has a direction to take us. Praise the Lord. So the father must come out the vision, must show us direction, and the father must be the leader of the house. He must lead. He must lead. He is the leader of the home. The father must lead. And I pray he leads in the right direction.
Amen.
Not leading us through hell.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So how do you do all this job as a father? You must create spiritual devotion. You must have devotion in your homes. to keep the home together. It's a must. You must create that temple for the family. It is not the mother that should do it. It is the man that must insist that there is devotion to God in this house. Number two, he must take the lead financially. He must have a financial vision for the family. Not when money comes to the hands of the man, it ended in the hands of strange women. The man must have his family in his focus to provide financially. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The scripture actually says a man cannot provide for his own house. Is what? Say it. Say it, brothers. Now you talk. Is worse than an unbeliever. Socially, if you want this family to stay together, we have to have social relationship. We must get together. And I was sharing with mommy before, yesterday I think, we're sharing. We used to play chess together. Prayers would be on my neck all of the time. We have this family time. We call it family time, isn't it? We have family time. And with the busy schedules that I have, she will insist we do the things. Sometimes to do family time, I'll take her to the park. And we do some running around and jumping around. We have to do that together to keep the family together.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
To secure bond. The capacity that we need to build is in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25. Please read when you get home. Husband, you are meant to love the wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself for the church. Secondly, husband, you are supposed to train. The responsibility of training the children. Remember, teaching is different from training. Training will bring character, will bring behavior, will bring attitude, will bring the do's and the don'ts of the family. The training responsibility is not exactly on the mother. It's not. It's on the father. It's on the father. It is the father that trains a child. And I don't have time to stress that, but there's a lot that I can tell you about that. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The father's responsibility, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4. If you look at it, and you do a study on that, I did a study on that already. The training up of a child is the father's responsibility. So you train the child. You train the child. Any child that is untrained is a sign of the absence of the father. And let me end with this. I have mentioned some things, but there are things I left out, but let me end with this. There was a study I told the single people when we had our meeting. A training was done in America. A research was done in America about those who are in jail, in prison, the children that ended up in the jail. And they found out that about 70% of those who ended in jail were children raised by single mothers. Children raised by single mothers. But the 30% of those raised by single parents were the only one found in prison. Meaning, there is a large capacity given to man to be able to raise a child. And that boy or girl, the capacity rests on the man. So I call fathers to their duties today. In South Africa, beginning from our church, let every father take their responsibility. Be interested in those children. And you thought it's your mother's, your children of your mother. No. You are responsible for them. Train them up. And to those who are single mothers and you do not have a husband at the moment, I want you to understand you are not alone. If God will allow you to do two responsibilities together, Just as the weaker vessel that the scripture calls, it means it gave you the capacity to achieve it. Now receive grace and strength now in the name of Jesus Christ. That your children will not be by words, they will not be littering the street corners, but they will be in the similitude of the palace in the name of Jesus Christ. Our children shall not be on the street corners. Oh, you didn't hear that? I said they shall not be on the street corners in the name of Jesus Christ. We will raise soldiers for Christ. We will raise armies in the kingdom of God. We will raise disciplined and God-fearing children in the name of Jesus. We will raise a family that is strong and resilient. Strong and resilient. Lift up your hand, let me pray for you. In Matthew 16, 18 and 19, Jesus says, I will build my church upon this rock, and the gate of hell shall not prevail against it. Concerning your family, anything that has fought down, kept your family down, kept your children down, kept them confused, kept your wife to become antagonistic towards you, anything that has made your life as a child to become like somebody miserable and you have no direction at the moment, I come against it in the name of Jesus. Satan, I can see you are behind all this. I confront you. I rebuke you. I cut off your influence over our families. In the name of Jesus Christ. I beg the power of Satan over every home, over every child, over every mother, over every father. I declare now, your hands, take it off our families. Our families are hereby built upon Christ the solid rock. I engage angels now to go forth and begin to mend every broken world. Every abuse, every molestation, every discouragement, every confusion, every commotion, every violence, every offense, every bitterness, every anger in the families, I declare, come to an end now in the name of Jesus Christ. I bless your families. I bless your families with the peace that comes from God. Let there be peace in your various families. I talk to our family members here as they receive peace in your families. In the name of Jesus Christ. Jesus rose and he rebuked the storm. He rebuked the wind. And he commanded calm. I command calm in your situation now. Your emotions that are so attacked and afflicted as a family member, be healed now by the power of the Holy Spirit. As I be healed now in the name of Jesus. Satan, I rebuke you by the authority of God's word. Take your hands off God's heritage. We are happy family members. From this day, everything that is attacking our finances, I come against it in the name of Jesus. Money makes things go round. And if you deprive a family of supplies, you are bringing all manner of trouble. I address the issue of scarcity in families. Do you want to agree with me? Anything causing scarcity in your family, anything causing dryness in your family. So, the enemy afflicts the mother so she cannot provide. The enemy attacks the father's finances so that there is no provision, so that the children will suffer. The enemy obstructs business transactions so that things will not be easy. I come against you by the word of the living God. I break your powers over God's people and let loose our resources. Loose our resources. Everything you have swallowed up, I command from it in the name of Jesus Christ. Release our treasures. Release the blessings. In the name of Jesus Christ. Today, in our family day, I declare. declare the powerhouse families. You are lifted above corruption. You are resilient families. You are strong and you are capable families. No family will break down anymore. I said, no family will break down anymore. No sorrows will come to any of the families. In the glorious name of Jesus. Hallelujah to the word of God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.